Okay, nett. I want to give you a small tutorial on how to build LoveCD. And first, I have to tell you that I'm not the one that built LoveCD on SUSE presently, but it's Thorsten Duhner. Unfortunately, he had an accident and a really complicated ankle fracture, and he's presently recovering. So I was asked to do the talk. I did live CDs up to 2 years ago for this, so people came actually to me and asked me to just give an introduction. But I will present this short overview of how a live CD works. And then I will present you with my experience at building a live CD with a script that's available at OpenSUSE. Okay, if there a question that are too technical, I probably won't be able to answer. But I try. So, what is a live CD? Live CD is just a CD. It runs from CD, doesn't have data except from CD, and you don't have to install it. Yeah. That's about it. Now, what do you need it for? Or what could you use it for? We use it here too, we use it to demonstrate our distribution. For the users could just pick up a live DVD and put it into a computer and just run it within a few minutes. You don't have to install anything. And most things basically work out of the box then. You could use it as a rescue tool because it has, unlike the rescue system we deliver with our distribution, it has practically everything you might need in a DVD. You could use it, for instance, for security reasons as a firewall tool, because you just can't modify anything if it runs from the CD. Knoppix, on the other hand, are coming from the other side. They started from a live CD and slowly developed into a full distribution. You can install a Knoppix on your computer, you just don't have to run it from CD. Because one of the drawbacks of running from CD is it's very resource intensive. You need a fairly fast computer, you need a fairly good amount of RAM to get it running at a decent speed. So, before we get go into the detail, just an overview. We just boot a normal kernel, we boot a slightly larger initRB. Then not in the normal init process is started, but the setup tool that loads storage modules and tries to locate the CD. And once it has done it, it mounts the CD, adds all the files that it finds there, and then the tricky part starts because you just can't run on only files. You need to have some writable directory, and this is really the tricky part at creating CD. So at this stage, data that have to be writable are copied in the RAM disk. Then the root directory is changed, and you, at this point you have a normal Unix running, and the normal init is started and things work as normal. So now I'm going to tell you about my experience last week when I picked up just the scripts from OpenSUSE and run it and look what happens. So what do you need? You need some SUSE Linux installation media, or you can use the OpenSUSE factory tree. That is, you need all the packages. You can't just run the script on your running system. Or put or put it another way, you don't want to share. You could probably do it with a small amount of hacking, but it's normally not what you want. Then you need the LiveCD script. You can just pick it up at forge.com. Unfortunately, the link is rather complex. The easiest way is to search for LiveCD on Forge, and it's the second tip. Leads you to the home page and the subversion. So, subversion tree is the only data that are available. Don't get distracted that there's nearly no well-designed home page with documentation and stuff. Just check out the latest and download it. The next step is to read the documentation. It comes with one README file. And actually, the README is very good. It's rather short, but it explains it step by step. And if you follow it, you're almost certain to succeed. Actually, it would have worked for me the first time when someone would have to told me that I had to install a CDUM package. I didn't know about it. I ended up with a 0-byte live CD, and that's not exactly what I expected. So, you need all the stuff on Forge, and you need the CDUM package. It's in open source factory, you can just grab it and install it. And the thing that's important in the CDUM package is the script that creates the compressed file system. The thing the script is called create compressed file system. So, now that you have all the data, what next? After reading the README, you know that there's a default config file. It's in the directory config, and there are certain things you have to set up. And most important are build area. Build area is just the place on the disk where you want to keep all the temporary data and where your LiveCD will be created in. Probably 4 or 5 gigabytes should be enough. But more doesn't hurt. RPM path is a common separated list of directories with RPMs. I didn't get that to work, but Thorsten told me it should. But what did work is I used an RPM path that to a DVD repository, so you don't have the individual CD trees. It should work if you set up. I think we have 5 CDs, and you would have to put 5 elements in the path. It's expected to work, but I think it does not. It works in any, it works guaranteed with a DVD source. So, and the next step is to define the size of your CD. What kind of packages do you want to have on it? And that's MySell. It specifies the selection. You would basically start with a normal KDE or something, or if you don't want graphics, you can start with a minimum selection, and then you want to add a certain package you really want to have on it, or you see, oh, it's really large, I don't want OpenOffice, and you would remove it. And that's the important point with my selection. The argument is a file I'm going to describe with the syntax a bit in the next slide. Another thing that's not on the slide you would want to put in this config file is the set of languages you want to support. And what effect does it have? It just selects translation packages for all the other things. It adds translation packages. Translation from packages are a rather large part of a distribution. So if you are about to save space because your goal is to fit it on a CD that you don't want to be reading, you probably don't want too much language support at the time. Now, how does the MySell argument? It's a package list and it's a plain text file. Then etcsyntype. You start with an equal sign, and after the equal sign, you specify a basic selection. The selection is something like a KDE or default. It's a .zel file set in our installation source. And then you can add or remove individual packages. Yeah. And then you run make list of RPMs. That's the start of the script, the text. All of the things are specified and resolves package dependencies on it. Because yeah, just adding like a GNOME package will require a lot of libraries. And you don't want to specify them individually, it resolves it. And it will add back package. Even if you remove a certain package, you may end up getting it back in because it's required another package. So, at the end of this point, it will even tell you an estimate of the size of the DVD. That gives you a sensible number, and there are not too many error messages at this make list of RPMs. Then you've done the first step. And now you can start to set up the installer. And you would make the make target this. May look a bit strange, but it's actual files or directories that are created inside the tree that are set up. And it's just for make logs. So next step is you run make sbin, make inner sbin, and it will install the packages. It's just a single RPM minus U call, and if you're very lucky, it will succeed without any error. And it will continue with applying patches and installing additional data, because it doesn't just work to take a normal system and put it on CD. There are certain fixes you want to have, because things are different on like CD. For instance, RC script aren't aware that your media is already mounted by the CD setup or init that runs prior to the real init. And there are places where things like file systems are mounted. And such things are a bit different on the live CD. You just don't want to unmount your live CD, for instance, within the process of running the RC script, because then you just end at nowhere. Yeah. And therefore, there's a small amount of patches that fixes up shut-up scripts. And there's a small set of data that are not in RPMs. I think at the moment, it's, for instance, OpenOffice user setup. Because otherwise, when you start your live CD, and the user just opens OpenOffice the first time, it seems, oh, it's really new. And it starts up with pop-ups and asks you to confirm if it may want to copy things into your directory, and it sets up all that stuff. And for that not to happen, you can add a pre-configured user this way. So the user starts and it just doesn't have to worry to set up all the things that are normally done the first time, because it's always the first time and you don't want it every time. Or another example would be a GIMP searching for plugins and stuff that just takes time but doesn't give you any value. So you would do it one once and just copy the config into the directory. So the trick is it didn't work the first time for me, and just simply because the install all packages returned an error code for me, because there was one package, I don't remember, it wasn't really happy out of the 1000 packages, and RPM came up with exit 1, and the scripts are written in a way that they stop at this point, and you're lost. And so the easy way is if you can't get it, the RPM is really installing without an error, it's just a small widget and you don't care about it and just want to continue. Just go into this, it's a normal makefile, it's very easy, you just look at the script and make it continue at this place. That's what I did. So it didn't really perfectly install, but the worst part was the patches were not applied after it, and that's what even worse. So I got it continuing after the install, I just logged on the error code and continued to apply patches and the data, and it was much better afterwards. Well, the visible effect was, for instance, the default user was there was no Linux user, and I ended up with a root login without password, and it just didn't work. This is another part of patches and things you want to have added. Yeah? Oh, yeah, good question.
Yes. On the previous slide, you said you had to start from the SUSE repository. Can you add other repositories if you want to add software from user local bin or Pacman?
So, you mean that's fine, yeah?
Yeah. Or did that misunderstand you?
Yeah, it doesn't matter. You just need a set of RPM. And that's why, in my view, in some, that's why there's an RPM path except a set of repositories. You can. It's just the idea, you have a basic stuff with just the default, and you want your KDE and or your packages added, and you just add it to the RPM path via and specify it in my collections as packages to edit, and it just works. Provided RPM likes it as it is, and it doesn't conflict with any package. It's really annoying, I know it from my time at building ICA. It's really a time-consuming part to find a set of packages that really works. Now, at this point, your later root file system with all the stuff is ready. It's sitting in a directory and waiting to be dealt with later. Now you need to build the setup tool, which is running as init in the first, call it installation phase, and before the real init is started. And this is a tool that has to load all the storage modules, and it's going looking for the CD and mounts the compressed files on it. And that's the reason why you have the make CD setup after make inner after building the tree. You could, if everything works, you could just call make. But I'm going through the individual make steps in the night order, because almost certainly just running make on the scripts will not work for you. So you build this, and it needs kernel module info. It extracts the kernel module info, so it knows which modules to load in it. Takes the PCI table as well. That's the reason why it's low. Otherwise, you could make it at first, you could really fast that. This 100% works, it just works. So, now is the time to take all the tree you've installed before and put it into a compressed file system. Therefore, you would run make outer ethon. It will build a small init ID that's run from the team. It has basically the kernel modules and the setup tool in it. then it will go and take your large 2D you installed and convert it into an ISO image. It could, in theory, you could take many other files, you could make it in X2 or so, but an advantage is that files are in the ISO are laid out just after now, and you don't have too much head movements. Otherwise, it doesn't really matter. Now, that one is compressed to a CLU image, and that's why we need the CLU package, and this was where my first attempt miserably failed. So, and yeah, that's about it. And now all the files, it creates a CLU image, a curl in Italy, it's just taken, put onto put it to a directory, and normal ISO is created from it. And at this stage, you are ready to try it. Yeah, okay, now that you have it, you probably want to test it. And if you're doing that regularly, or you have a special requirement that that force you to do to rebuild and test it more often, you will see that burning a CD is a time-consuming process, and maybe there's some easier way. So, just if you have your own RPMs, so just to edit there. And one thing you should be aware of, if you are going for a DVD, it probably doesn't matter, but if you want a CD, you will see that, that the estimation you get at the first step is not really accurate. It's obvious, but it's fairly close. And just as I mentioned, there are several points where you would like the scripts to continue, even with small errors. For instance, the patches might not, the patches I talked about might just not get in because the RPMs with the original RC file change or something. And you don't mind at the first. You can just fix it up later, but you just want to have it running. So don't hesitate, just look at the scripts, easy bash scripts, and comment out all the exits. And there's a, if you don't want to burn a CD, you can use a disk partition for testing. The config file I mentioned in the first slide has a comment and out section where you could specify a hard disk partition. And the CD setup tool is not looking for a CD, but for partition, you just call the partition process. Yeah, and provided everything worked, it took on a fast machine, and it takes about half an hour or so to go all the scripts and have it built to a final image. Oh, future. Okay, there's before we go to the future, there are some things you should be aware of. There are some patches. Even if the patches don't work, there are some core things that that must work. For instance, there's a XOR setup, and you really want an auto setup for your XOR, and therefore one of the patches changes the running order of the RC script to put the ZAX, our setup tool for X11, to change it more to the top, and to start an auto config. That's one of the points that didn't work for me the first time. And the visible effect is that you end up in run level 5, and the XSOL is, I think, 5 times tried for restarting, and then it gives up. So this is probably one thing you want to fix, or at least to watch out for. Yeah, and of course you should, another thing that easily might happen is that I mentioned that the user is not created, so you don't have a user, you can do linears. Or the run level is not correctly set. But if that's, that everything's met, and you get a KDM or GDM or GDPROM, then you've probably done 99% right. So, what could be improved? First, there's just one catch I ran into that's normally documented. The create compressed file system script or program is a bug. I've said Torsten already in the catch, but the visible effect is it creates a wrong image. So your C loop image it creates, that's the one I mentioned here, is not accepted by the C loop modulator. It says, oh, it's all broken. And it happens if your block size is divided, is a multiple of 2k. So yeah, I think because then the last block is 0 bytes in size, and he forgets to add it, and the C loop module later notices and says, oh, I don't know, the end doesn't fit, I won't accept it. And you will run into it in, I think the default is 16k block size, and with a chance of 1 of 8. So you probably won't, but if it does happen, you know what you're about. It's a trivial fix that probably will end up on the subversion repositories. So what's the future? What could we do? So for instance, we could dump the C loop stuff and the ESO image stuff and just use a compressed file system like squash it as. We had some experiments with compressed X5 file system in the past, but it didn't work very well, so we ended with the C loop. It's not an official kernel yet, so I'm not sure how it is. Another thing is, all this copying into RAMDIS is rather tedious and doesn't really look good. UnionFS is an approach for it, but in theory it would work better. I don't know exactly what I think, not exactly. And it would just give you the opportunity to have a read-only file system in the background and just write your changes on top of it. So it's exactly what you want for live TD. So this is truly one thing to consider for the future. Another thing is, audio changes are lost. And it would be, if you are working with a, you probably want to save this data at some point. You could do it on USB storage or hard disk partition, for instance. It's currently not done. It has the advantage that your hard disk is not touched at all, which is only a good thing. But unfortunately, your files are lost. We had this at some point in the past, we had to, our live teams had the ability to store things on the disk partitions, but there were problems on machines where you couldn't figure out the RAID layout stuff. and it would, for instance, if you had a RAID 1, it would start to write in one partition and you would end up with an inconsistent RAID system. So it has it always. But to store it on USB should probably be safe. So there's some issues in Telex. You could, in theory, run it on a network, obviously. You have the read only tree lying on a network server. And just boot a small CD to access it. There's no real good use. Maybe you want to track a file access order. I had used it in the past to speed up development, which is really good. Which does really good, very good. Because it's very fast. You just go and edit the config in your tree and boot the CD, and it's just a turnaround time of 1-2 minutes. And you have the results. The trick is that you must make sure that your network setup scripts don't cut your network connection and suffer. Because at this point, you lose connection. Otherwise, it's a nice idea. Yeah, that's it. Are questions? Yeah.
I have a question about the hardware compatibility of SUSE. Of course, I experienced, I couldn't find the RPM packages in the Broadcom Gigabyte onboard chip. In the case of the, I can't find the compatible RPM packages all over the world. Do you have any mail contacts to confirm the available device? I cannot find any RPM packages of the device drivers for specific devices.
Yeah.
Do you have any contact point to confirm?
You're speaking about total modules.
Yes. If possible, my question is very simple. Do you have any contact point to confirm the
Just to be sure, does it have something to do with life skills? General question.
General question.
You want to know where to look for a person that knows more about support kernel modules or other
yes,
support.
Yes.
You could just open the backup port. If you're missing some feature, say your hardware is not supported, just go to the model site and open it. And Maxilla entry, and then it's really I can do it. We have several developers working on the various topics, and
yes.
it will get redirected to the person that already knows on almost.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, just the bug reports is a good way to ask. Okay. Ah, yeah, Nick. Yeah.
Do you plan to include a small feature to allow to install your SUSE system from the live CD? So you test the live CD, you like it, and then you say, okay, install.
Yeah.
Should be that possible in respect of the...
So you want an install feature for you. Say the user runs the live CD and wants to install it.
To be able to install the whole system from the live CD.
The very system that's presently on.
From the live CD.
Yeah. The live CD in fact you want to install. You can edit. It's a public repository. But I just can't speak for Thorsten. It's probably not too difficult. You would have to fix your FSTAP entry
code. I'm thinking in that yes module which is called installing to the right directory.
Do you want a module to install live to you?
it could be easy.
So you're basically asking for a live 3D setup module.
Maybe just for the capacity to install the whole system from the live CD. Sort of easy. It's an easy way for people who like the system at all and wants to install it.
It's starting not empty.
Some distributions has it already. So that's because I'm asking the right way to do it in SUSE's way.
I'm not exactly sure. You want to install the things from LiveCD?
To install the whole system from the LiveCD, yeah. Some distributions they have, they are using LiveCD. You put it in your computer, start, you can play with it, and later they have a sort of application or anything about it. So I like it that, install. And then the problem of what it does is installing the whole system in the hard disk.
Yeah. So you want the digital packages in a normal way installed? That's an alternative.
No, maybe I'm just asking which would be the right way to do that.
Yeah, on the, I think we have a promotion DVD for 10.2, and it had a live CD on it and an equivalent set of packages to install into the system. It could be amazing. The Knoppix is just copying over on the system. Could add such a feature, but it's not specific to live CD, I think. It's just a, say, bootloader selection feature or something, where you put select an alternative and then install it. Yeah, it's good. Yeah, it's brilliant.
I didn't see you mentioned, but a whole bunch of live CDs have an option at boot time that you can select certain or deselect certain parameters, like switch off power management, USB.
Yeah, it would be a good feature. Yeah. I'm not aware of it. I don't think that. I haven't looked at the source for the 3D setup to source the most probably in all. Any more questions? Okay, let's finish it. Right, thank you.